what we learned yesterday was that Mr. Trump tried to enlist the FBI, and when they refused, he went to the House and Senate Intelligence Committee chairs to stifle the stories about his ties to Russia. Since the Congressional Intelligence Committee chairs agreed and have been speaking on his behalf, this makes it highly unlikely that the Congressional Republicans can conduct an impartial investigation. So yesterday, I read that Representative Darrell Issa called for a special prosecutor to be appointed to investigate Mr. Trump's ties to Russia. So my first question to Representative Lewis is, when you join your colleague, Representative Issa, in supporting an immediate investigation by a special prosecutor? Yeah. Was White House interference in an ongoing investigation. My question now to Representative Lewis is, if Mr. Trump is found to have broken the law or violated the Constitution, will you support impeachment?
Him would be, would you support allowing the general public to buy into and expand our successful Medicare program?
My name is Bob Robbins. I live in Inver Grove Heights, and nobody paid me to be here today. PBS program Almanac, Jason Lewis was on the show, and he spoke about repealing the Affordable Care Act. And my conclusion from what he has to say is that he plans to repeal the Affordable Care Act in the worst possible way, that is, namely, by hacking it piece by piece apart over a period of 2 years, which is going to leave people in all kinds of untenable positions because little pieces of it go away, other pieces of it stay in place. That's guaranteed to make it not work. So would Jason Lewis please reconsider about repealing it in one action when the time is when there is another plan in place already?
Just pass. ties between Donald Trump and Russia. Additionally, Attorney General Jeff Sessions has refused to recuse himself from any investigation concerning those ties, even though he was nominated to his current position by Mr. Trump and active in Mr. Trump's campaign. My question, Mr. Lewis, will you vote in favor of a resolution of inquiry to investigate the relationship between Mr. Trump and his staff with Russia, as well as any conflicts of interest, and support an independent, bipartisan, transparent committee, not just the House Judicial Committee, because they don't have to follow the same rules of transparency, with subpoena power to fully and completely investigate those relationships to include the release of Donald Trump's tax returns?
So I'm a little nervous, but I wanted to say I'm really concerned, Donald Trump said, you know, through his campaign, and that he wanted to unite our country. I'm concerned about what Mr. Bannon said recently, asking Republicans and the people that voted for Mr. Trump to stand up and fight against the Democrats. These are divisive words and strike against our democracy. On another note, President Trump also said that he has a heart. I'm concerned for our immigrants. Recently there was a woman in Texas who was scheduled for, she has a brain tumor, was scheduled for a surgery, and she was now detained and will be supported. There was a 23-year-old boy, all his family's here, came over here as a child. He doesn't speak Spanish, he doesn't know the culture, and he was deported. Where is your heart? Where is this cabinet's heart? So my question to Mr. Lewis is, Representative Lewis, is will you go against party lines to do the right thing?
Today, but I came here with my four-year-old, and I have a two-year-old at home, and I just want to remind him that they are his constituents too. He represents our children, and I think it's his responsibility, Mr. Lewis, it's your responsibility to provide a robust and well-funded school system that educates our children, regardless of who they are, what they look like, what pronouns they choose to use. And in addition to our public education, our children deserve to have an environment that they can inherit that functions, an environment that does not have dead fish floating up everywhere.
Widespread voter fraud. He insists this without providing any proof. And at the same time, Republicans in the House of Representatives are trying to eliminate the Election Assistance Commission, the only federal body which is charged with trying to ensure the integrity of our elections. I would like to ask Congressman Lewis whether he supports that and how in God's name that makes any sense. I want to say something to the people who may be watching this on Facebook, and that is, you need to get involved. You need to be here. Yeah. I looked up the statistics just this morning, and it's rather mind-boggling. If you look at the entire voting-eligible population of the United States, the final tally in the presidential election was something like Hillary Clinton with 25.6% of the vote, Donald Trump with 25.3% of the vote, and 44% of eligible Americans didn't vote. If they had all voted as a block, they could have decided who the next president was. You get the government that you stand up and ask for, so get out and do something.
They're trying trying to make sure that people can hear who are watching, so. Thank you so much.
So remember, signs are reversed now. Just to be clear, I almost said this way.
I don't want to block anybody.
Thank you.
Oh, we're fine.
Hi, my name is Jim Carlson, and I am one of the... But I also am the sitting senator from District 51, which includes Burnsville and Egan. And we are up at the legislature trying to fix a lot of things that are going wrong. And some of the repairs for instance, health care, which is the number one issue that people have on their minds. The legislature in Minnesota has already done a lot. What we did was we managed to get a 25% discount for these particular premiums that are purchased by people in the individual market. We took that out of the reserves, which is not the best thing to do, but that was the consensus that the governor made with the other side. And we've been trying to work on that. We still have a lot to do. But what we don't know, and the reason that I'm here, I'm asking Congressman Lewis, what are you going to do federally? Because we're waiting for those movements. Right now, they don't have anything. The Minnesota legislature, the Republicans, don't have anything. We don't know what he's going to do. We don't know what they're going to pass. We hear that they're constantly working on it, but we've heard that for the last, how many years now?
8 years.
So we need something, and we need something now. I'm here with Representative Mason, and we have a lot to do up at the legislature to work on things like we know that there's a lot of bills for voter suppression. And that's very serious. And we need you to keep attention on them. We're going to be voting on Monday on a bill that has a lot of voter suppression in it. So that's something that I'm hoping that everyone takes a very good notice of. And I'm now going to excuse myself because I can't possibly do as good a job as you're already doing in asking these questions of Congressman Lewis. And you know, you are now doing what he should be doing, and that's holding a town hall and a listening session. And so I'm listening also, but this is for him, and I want to thank the people for arranging it, because, you know, in fact, Sandy and I, we always have to arrange our own.
You are so nice. Because you're doing your job. You're doing your job.
This is
what's the bill number on that?
Yeah, 1220, Senate file 1225.
1225.
But... thank you, Congressman Lewis. If you do happen to come and sneak into the audience, I really appreciate you coming. But if you're not, you know, I'm hoping you're enjoying the video.
Hello, I'm Reverend Rob Smith. I live in Burnsville. I'm a pastor serving in Apple Valley, and I'm really encouraged today. We are measured a lot by how we care for our most vulnerable, and there's a lot to be concerned about. One particularly is the scapegoating and the rhetoric surrounding immigration, and especially refugees. I'm concerned with how we speak about, how we demonize, and I would like to ask Representative Lewis if he's meeting with people right here in Dakota County. We have people who have filed asylum that are in process that are scared with changes in the possibility of being denied that have been here for years. They're scared of dates coming up where they need to refile their visas, and will they be denied? And they have families. They are contributing greatly into our communities. They are working, and I have great concerns. And I would like to know if he is meeting in our community, with our immigrants, with our people that are seeking asylum, and can we make sure that we are caring for our most vulnerable right here at home?
Okay. See you.
sounded nice.
My name is Lynn Sansom. My husband Paul is out here someplace. And he's outside. He was supposed to be here to give me courage. We're South St. Paul, and we have three grown children, and one has cerebral palsy. That's our oldest daughter, Jenny. And what I wanted to talk to you about was Medicaid, which is happening next week. You've got to make your calls tomorrow. You have to make your calls tomorrow. I heard 2 weeks ago from a Republican that this was going to start happening. They were finally going to get all the big cuts that they'd wanted for years. And of course, now they can do it. So that's what's going to be happening next week. What Medicaid does, if you don't, and I'm sure most of you know, it insures health care, it insures services for the disabled of all ages. It gives, it helps the elderly, it helps low-income adults, it helps children. And what happened is, I was a Republican in 1986, I'm embarrassed to say, and what happened is the Governor's Council developmentally disabled asked for 30 parents to come forward to be trained as advocates, and we were going to be part of the legislation to try to get rid of the state hospitals throughout the country that housed and warehoused the disabled. And if any of you want to know, it hasn't been that long. You can Google up, you've all got phones, Willowbrook. Look up Willowbrook. It was an institution in Staten Island closed in 1987. These, look at the images. I mean, it hasn't, it's changed, but it hasn't been that long. What's going to happen now? A lot of those people, it worked. We went to Washington, D.C., and it was interesting because they said, who do you want to meet with? And so we all had to give our list of our representatives. Mine were Republicans. And they said, they won't see you. And I said, of course they will. And they said, no, they won't. And they would not. And I thought, how can they not care? How can they not care as a group? But they didn't. They didn't. Not one would see me. I've never forgotten that. But what you've got to do is, remember, they're in charge now, and these deep cuts are coming, and it's going to affect all of us in Minnesota, because what usually has happened is the federal government ensures it's an open-ended commitment of funding to Minnesota. Now they want to put it through in per capita or block grants, which is really going to hurt, and it's not going to be open-ended. And so it's going to put the burden back on counties and back on states and back on all of you. And services are going to be hurt. I mean, our daughter is now, she is in a small group home of four young women. She can go to the library. She can go to the state fair. She can go down to the library. She can go to movies. It's a normal life for her. And I'm worried that these state hospitals, a lot of them were demolished. A lot of them were repurposed. A lot of them stand empty, and I just wonder what they're waiting for. And I just wish they would have ripped them all down. But a lot of them still stand. And we don't want them to fill back up. We do not want nursing homes, ICF, MRs, to fill back up with the disabled. I mean, that's not the life. We've got it the way it should be for our most vulnerable people. And we want that to remain. So you have to call early. They say it's going to happen fast, and it's going to happen next week.
So if you agree that vulnerable people should be protected. I would only disagree with you if you did a beautiful job on one thing, because she said they're in charge. And what does our Constitution start with?
We need people!
And I got to without being emotional. And I was like,
hi, I'm Jeff Goldie. I'm an Air Force veteran. I was a base legal officer for 9 years. I got two topics I want to touch on very quickly. I want to ask Congressman Lewis, I'm not sure where his chair went, but yeah, okay. Congressman, I didn't mean to be so close. I want to ask Congressman Lewis how he feels about making sure that the CIA and our military members are not committing war crimes by committing acts of torture to include waterboarding, by not being asked to intentionally bomb civilian populations and by not plundering another country of its natural resources. The second topic was touched on by our state senator a few minutes ago, and that's election reform. Congressman Lewis, how would you feel about the following federal election reform? One, automatic voter registration for every eligible voter in the country. Two, no photo ID requirement anywhere. And three, federal election days will become a national holiday and no one will be required to work. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Sandy Simonson. I reside in Lakeville, and I'm not paid to be here. Wasn't actually even planning to be here. I actually came to the Somali dance troupe thing and found out that this was the town hall was going to be there. And for those of you who missed it, it was great, and it was wonderful experience. So they left a lot of positive energy in this room, which I thanked them for. What I wanted to bring up is we're hearing there are so many issues that need to be addressed, and we're being, there's a lot of attack, as I would call it anyway, on citizens. And so what I want you all to, you know, to remember is we all need to encourage each other because we are trying to make sure that democracy is not eroded. And as you can see by the votes that have already been taking place, the ones that are coming up, not only at the national level, but also at the state level, there are numerous attempts being made to erode democracy. And there are numerous attempts being made to silence citizens, which means it is not a democracy. And the final thing I wanted to say is that I just came out this week, for those of you who get that free this week paper that comes all to our individual communities. At least in my community, it did come out in Lakeville. I actually just put in a letter to the editor regarding oppression and speaking up against oppression, because there was a column who had appeared about just saying if we all act nice, and which is good. We all need to act nice. We all need to be respectful. But that does not end systematic racism and systematic issues that really do truly impact individuals, which has already been talked about today in a number of different areas. And because one of the things that I actually said in that letter to the editor, that when oppression exists, democracy is only a privilege for some, not an inherent right for all.
Hello, Congressman Lewis. My name is John Book. I'm with Burnsville Lakeville Indivisible. And the one topic out of so many that are facing us, the one, too, that we need to keep our eye on is climate change. Yep. I mean, we've all experienced an incredibly warm winter. It's going on around the world. I work with an organization that works with poor and marginalized people overseas, and they are being uprooted and hammered. It's a security issue around the world. It's a security issue for us. It's a justice issue. and it's nonpartisan. It impacts all of us. We're all in this together. So what are you going to do to help keep within the overall goal of only a 2-degree change here in climate so that we don't just burn up our planet?
Hi, my name is Jackie Schaff. I'm a kindergarten teacher, and I work and live in the district that Jason Lewis represents. So I know we've had some people that have come up and talked about the House Bill 610 that is going to be voted on. We know that that bill is going to take a lot of funding from public schools, and I've seen statistics that say around 95% of students in Minnesota attend a public school. So my question for Congressman Lewis would be, what is he doing to represent those 95% of Minnesota kids that are in public schools?
The House is in agreement with that question.
For a little guy like me. Thank you for laughing. My name is Kevin Wagner. I'm from Shakopee. And thank you. Thank you very much. My question, I have a couple different questions. Well, first let me do some self-disclosure. I am a staunch independent. I truly believe the problems we have in this country are both the fault of the Republicans and the Democrats. When you put a party's agenda ahead of the people's, we have a problem. And that's what both sides have done. My next thing is, I was foolish enough to vote for Jason.
Uh-oh.
Because I foolishly believed he would, thank you, he would put us ahead of the Republican agenda.
Thank you for being here.
Let me tell you, I will not make that mistake again. My question for Jason is, does he believe that it is a fundamental guaranteed right of every American citizen to have health care?
Yes.
Part two of that question is, what is the repeal, replace plan? And three, would he and his fellow colleagues in Congress be willing to be under the same plan as the rest of us? My next question, my background is in higher education. I have almost 25 years working at various institutions of higher learning across the country. I sit in my office and hear horror stories of students that will graduate hundreds of thousands of dollars in debt. Yes. Would Jason support a plan that guarantees students who go to public institutions would receive free higher education?
Hey folks, I hope you're not tired of hearing from me yet. I just wanted to say that I don't know how well this is going to be represented in the cameras, but we have hundreds of people here. And not only in this room, but from my vantage point on the side, I can see out the window, we've had dozens of people outside rallying. It looks like they've gotten tired of the cold at this point, but we have people who can't be in this room that still want to be a part of the process, and people who Jason Lewis doesn't seem to want to hear. We have reached out to him through so many forms, calling his office. We've shown up at his office. We've reached out to him online, and we've set up this event for him to come and interact with his constituency.
Two events.
So my question to Jason Lewis is, Where are you?
Yeah. My name is Kim Martinson. I retired in June after 38 years in education. I worked at Apple Valley High School and at East U High School for over 30 years in the state of Minnesota. I know what it is like to be a public servant. You all paid for your great education your kids have received. You have to know that we have some of the finest high schools. I worked at high schools in the state of Minnesota and across the nation in District 2. Some of the finest. I am very concerned, Representative Lewis, that you won't come and visit us, that you won't talk to us, and that you do not understand what it means to be a public servant. I was an assistant principal, and I dealt with teenagers all day long for 38 years. And the thing that you have to know, what leaders do, whether you're working with teenagers or you're working with parents, or you're working with taxpayers, is that you listen to understand. You do not listen to make the next response, because that's what talk radio is about. And Jason Lewis is no longer a radio DJ. Jason, you are a public servant, and your job is to listen to each and every one of us, and to not ignore us, and to not just show up. So the last question that was asked is, where are you? These are the people who pay your bills and for whom you work. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Heidi. I live in Eagan. And I wanted to express concern that there's been talk of defunding the budget for the Violence Against Women Act.
Yes.
I am a survivor. I took advantage of these services in Olmsted County in 2008. It helped me get back on my feet to take care of my two toddler daughters that I was single parenting at the time. And last year, 21 women in the state of Minnesota, or 21 children and people, were killed due to domestic violence. Domestic violence is a leading, if not the leading, cause of death of pregnant women. So this is a real problem. The budget for it is about $1.48 per American per year. I'd like to ask Congressman Lewis to please protect that funding and to focus on real problems that we have, as opposed to that there is data to support that this is a real problem, a public safety problem for our police officers responding to those situations, and focus on those as opposed to imaginary problems that have no data, such as the ban of immigrants from all of those countries.
I live in Burnsville, and I'm nervous. I'm a wife and a mother of a five-year-old who's getting ready to enter school this year, which I'm already nervous about. I share all of your concerns, but my one question for Jason Lewis is, Jason, do you think that I have the right to live? And I hope you do. And I'd really like to just talk to you about that and just hear what you have to say. Because I'm one of these people who is draining the healthcare system. I am 37 and I have stage 4 breast cancer. And I've been living with it for 4.5 years. My daughter was diagnosed right after I stopped breastfeeding. But I'm still here and I'd really like to keep being here. But I'm really expensive for everyone. And so we really, really, so that I'm not a burden on anyone else, including my family, need a good plan to keep me here so that I can keep teaching my daughter, keep her involved, so that we can keep our country great, because it already is great.
That was a standing ovation for a woman who is saying she needs quality health care to save her life. Did you hear that, Jason? I want you to hear that. I want you to respond to her.
Follow up on what she was saying, and I wish you the best. I'm going to be praying for you, you know, and I know we all are, and I believe you're going to make it. But my son had a health care issue too a few years ago, heart condition, almost killed him, and fortunately he had health insurance. My name is John Dahl, by the way. I was actually a state senator for this area a few years ago. I worked with Jim Carlson, and health care is the issue we've got to deal with right now. We've got to solve this, and the only way we're going to solve this is all of us contribute. The problem I'm having with the approach that we're taking, it's always been a top-down approach. Listen to the lobbyists, listen to the insurance companies, the politicians in the Beltway decide, here's the plan everybody's going to have. Obamacare was a problem because of that approach. And the Republicans refused to deal with it. They refused to work with it. Now they've got that ball in their hands. But they're going to take the same approach, top-down. And they're going to take this HSA approach and buy insurance across state lines, all these things that aren't going to work, right? And what we need to do is make our voices heard, that we need a ground-up, a bottom-up approach. We need Representative Lewis to come and listen to our stories, to listen to your story, to listen to our ideas. Because this shouldn't be a competition between insurance companies. This should be a competition between ideas and how we actually solve our health care problems here in this country. We do have a great health care system if we can get access to it, but nobody can afford it. We can't afford these issues, and it's not a matter of if we're going to work with the health insurance system. It's when and what issue. And it's better if we were able to go in early and take care of things. HSAs, you go in to see the doctor and it's burned up. Then what do you do? All right. The solution they have, they talk about portability and all these other things. Sounds a lot to me like a Medicare for All program, right? Now, a couple weeks ago, Bernie Sanders and Ted Cruz had a debate on healthcare on CNN. I don't know how many of you saw that, all right? Now, that's the two narratives that we got going forward. We've got the Bernie Sanders or Medicare for All approach, and we have the market-based solutions approach. Well, they all talk about patient-centered reforms with healthcare. Well, we're all the patients. Why don't they come and listen to us? So I want to know how many of you think Jason Lewis, our representative, should come and listen to us specifically about fixing healthcare? How many of you think a top-down approach is going to actually solve anything? Come for healthcare. Do you think that if they just come up with another healthcare HSA approach, that's going to solve our healthcare problems?
No.
So I appeal to our representative here. please come and have some healthcare associated town hall meetings. Actually call for meetings or hearings at the federal level to listen to some of the alternative views, not just be living in a bubble that says this is the only approach we're going to listen to and then we're going to try to impose it on everyone else, because that is just going to provide another set of unworkable solutions for all of us. It's not going to solve our problems. Thank you.
My name is Mary Ellen Smith. I am from Burnsville. I'm from Farmington. I have to know where I'm from. I'm from Farmington, Minnesota. And no one has paid me to be here today. But I have worked in the Burnsville School District, and I will speak to the Burnsville School District. I think it's wonderful. I've been a nurse practitioner, a pediatric nurse practitioner for a number of years, providing health care to kids. I've worked as a school nurse in the Burnsville School District. And I'm amazed at the wonderful teachers that they have, and the fact that they have had nurses in all the schools to provide health services to the children. So I'm speaking here today to support a very robust education program. Keep the public schools. We're serving children both for their health and for their education. Kids can't learn if they're not healthy. The other issue I wanted to bring up that has not been brought up today is I'm very concerned about violence in our society and the number of guns that are out there and people having access to guns. I think it was despicable how at the federal level we could not get some kind of gun control legislation when we know that children are being murdered by people who should not have guns. We need to do something to curb that. And what is Mr. Lewis going to do about that? What is he going to do about conserving health care, providing a robust health care system so our kids can learn? And finally, you know, we cannot live for today with climate change. We need to do something now. Again, my purpose is I fear for our children. My own children, I fear for, and my grandchildren. So those are the issues that I feel very strongly about.
My name is Vaughn Ganong, and I'm also a constituent of yours, Mr. Lewis. I've been in Burnsville for about 5.5 years, and before that I lived in Lakeville for about 21. And my main concern has really already been covered and probably a lot more eloquently than I will, but that is Russian interference in our election. And I think that is the most serious threat to our democracy in my lifetime, for sure. More serious because of possible collusion with our current president and his campaign. And so I want to know, Mr. Lewis, if you support an independent bipartisan committee with a special prosecutor to investigate Trump's involvement in the Russian hacking, and also he needs to divulge his tax returns. It's obvious that the Republicans who are in Congress right now have no desire to perform their obligations to investigate that, which is their responsibility. And so it really can't be just a committee in Congress. It needs to be independent. And the last thing I'd like to say is that this president seems bound and determined to trample all over our First Amendment rights. And I'm very concerned about the suppression of the media and all the talk about fake news and now the banning of certain news outlets from the White House, and it's a threat to our democracy and free speech. And so, Mr. Lewis, the former post of our democracy, and so I'd like to know, Mr. Lewis, what you are going to do to defend our First Amendment rights.
Hi, my name is Kelly Rose. I have lived in Burnsville since 97, and no, I have not been paid to be here. I just want my voice to be heard. A lot of people have talked about a lot of the issues. There's just so many things wrong with this administration. One thing I wanted to talk specifically to Senator Representative Lewis about, because there's so many issues in the media. This doesn't get attention. He's in the House. The House keeps putting up these bills. Get rid of the EPA. Get rid of the Department of Education. You know, coal stuff in the rivers. You know, pollution again. He is specifically in a spot where he can start in the House getting people to push back against this deconstruction of the government. Steve Bannon has proudly said he's a deconstructionist. That is what they want to do, is deconstruct the government. And Lewis is going to say state versus federal. I don't buy that. You know, we have a very, very dangerous crew in D.C. right now. And Lewis has to stand up for America. Speaker mentioned the media issue. It's a constitutional issue. That's the First Amendment. They are attacking the democracy in America. I just want to dovetail on what she said. We do have a very dangerous crew in our United States Congress. And I want you to say the same legislation is being presented in the Minnesota House and Senate, and we have a very dangerous Minnesota House and Senate. Same legislation is being issued in almost every state of this country. So, who is writing that legislation, Jason, that you're presenting? Who is behind that? Who has written your legislation? Because you're not listening to We the People.
My name is Jenny. I'm a librarian, so information, data, communication, those things are all really important to me personally and as part of my career. I'm from South St. Paul. I grew up in Eagan. I've lived in this district my adult life. And one of the things that's really important to me, we all would love Representative Lewis to show up at an event like this. Beyond that, if he refuses to do so, I would love it, Representative, if you would find other ways to communicate with us. Technology is a wonderful tool. I got called at my house. Could I take part in one of these telephone town halls? They were like, it's starting right now. Who else has had that experience? I know, right? Well, and I was lucky that I happened to not be working that evening, and I happened to not be, you know, have anything else to do. I got on the phone call, it had already started. What? Why? Why isn't that being recorded? This meeting is being recorded by like 8 people. I want to see the transcripts of those telephone town halls. I want to hear the recording. Basic, man. Like, just the town hall so we can all hear what's going on, hear what our other constituents are saying, hear what he's saying back to them. We can all communicate in ways even if he's not willing to show up in person. So, thank you.
Not as an organizer, this is me as a constituent, clearly not paid, from Eagan. I don't understand how we define hate and threat anymore. Because the things that I don't think are threatening, like countries that have never attacked us, like refugees that are running from war-torn countries, those don't scare me. But white supremacists attacking people in our own country. Does this administration, including Jason Lewis, and I have put this to him in writing, talking, when do we start addressing our real threats here? And the latest with the transgender bathroom bill just kind of put me over the top. Because I'm lucky enough that I have a staff member there that gave me a cell number, and I've been kind of blowing that up. I think he's going to block me soon. But when do we start attacking children going to school? So if you're in agreement that we need to address the real hate in the country.
Hello, my name is Mary Mitchell. I'm a retired school teacher and I live right here in Burnsville, and I'm not paid to be here, but I am a constituent of Jason Lewis's. And I would like to address the Muslim travel ban. There are so many executive orders that just have been having me tear my hair out lately. I don't want a wall on the Mexican border. I don't want to send children who have been living their lives in America back to a country where they don't even speak the language. But I am especially, I am very upset by all of that, but especially by the Muslim ban. And let's face it, that's what it really is. So my question for Representative Lewis is, right here in this district, we have a very large community of immigrants. We have people from all nations here. We have a very big Somali population here, and I was fortunate enough to be here to watch the Somali dance group right before this meeting. How is Representative Lewis representing those members of his district? I noticed that in his first words to Congress, he said, and I'm quoting roughly, although I've got the exact quote with me, that he regarded representing us as a responsibility that he took very seriously. Well, obviously not, because he's not here. I've spoken to his office many times, and although they are very polite, I get no response to any of that. So that would be my question. Thanks a lot.
I want to just dovetail on what she just said when we talk about, like, what is really hateful in our country. And I have been upset with Jason Lewis long before he ran for it. I don't know if that's a surprise, because I listen to all sides of the argument, and I used to listen to him on talk radio, even though I don't like talk radio. I heard him fill in for Rush Limbaugh. And I've been listening for as long as I have, and went, this is so hateful. How can anybody, like, buy into those arguments? I thought they were so far-fetched that nobody could actually give them credence. Well, I was proved wrong. And Jason, I need you to hold yourself accountable for the hate speech that you put out on the radio airs all those years. I know some people say, well, today is a new day. No. When you make a mistake, and I've made many, you hold yourself accountable for that mistake. You say, you know, that was my error. I made a misjudgment. And then I do a correction plan. Jason, I expect you to do a correction plan for all that hate that you put out there on the radio. And if you do not, you do not belong in our House of Representatives. Unless your policies have heart in them, unless you're working to reflect the beautiful American heart, we have a beautiful heart in this audience, you do not belong in that House of Representatives. And if you think this country is a country of scarcity, you do not belong in the House of Representatives. We are the richest nation on this planet. We need to set the example. If you can't set an example, Jason,
You do not belong in the House of Representatives.
Good afternoon. My name is Gladys Briseño. I have been living in Minnesota for 2 years only. I live for 30 years in California. And I never felt the way I feel. I feel very scary. I feel rejected. And I raised my daughter loving this country, respect this country. And this administration is talking about immigrants, so ugly stuff that is not true. And that hurt our feelings. And what will you do? My daughter. What will you do if you live next to a rich country and you don't have opportunities and you don't have food on your table? Of course, you're gonna cross the river and come with the opportunities and that's what it is. So it's very sad to see these people going back. I know there's people that are not doing the right thing. Okay, they may be sending back, but there is people that are working very hard in this country for their dreams. I had my American dream. I had my business. I raised my daughter in a good way, loving this country. And I told her, you better love this country. You're from Mexico, from Guatemala, and from United States. And you better show it. Go to school and study. And don't throw trash on the floor. But it's very hard. I'm an American citizen. I did everything right. We don't feel the same anymore. And please have mercy on these people that just come here to work hard and they have their children here loving this country. Thank you.
First time I've ever done anything like this. I'm a retired teacher. Most of my audience was always 6 years old. So, I am a constituent. I've lived in Apple Valley for 40 years. My children went to K through 12 schools here. I have a couple of concerns. One was triggered by another comment. And back to climate, clean air, clean water, abolishing the EPA. So who is going to make sure that corporate and industrial polluters are going to have to clean up after themselves? That's my big concern. I have grandchildren. I hope to live to see my great-grandchildren. I want them to breathe clean air, and I want them to drink clean water. Connected to that, the climate issue. I firmly believe that most of the Republicans that are sitting there in Congress are smart enough to know that there is such a thing as climate change. There is such a thing as science. You are pretending to deny it because you are being owned by the fossil fuel industry. Wake up. Save our planet, for God's sake. My last thing is about the health care issue. You cannot talk about health care reform without talking about
the elephant in the room, the pharmaceutical companies. Yes. Yes. Who is holding them accountable for them? They are the single main problem with the cost of our health care. They pass the insurance companies pass that cost to them, or there are people out there who are dying because they can't afford their medication because of the unbelievable costs of some of the pharmaceuticals. Who's holding them accountable? Where is the talk about negotiating with the pharmaceutical companies?
She had to bring up the bathroom bill, so I thought I'd just respond quickly. I was on Almanac last night, if anybody wants more details. And then we talked about immigration, and we are a nation of immigrants. I think the wall around Mexico is the biggest taxpayer boondoggle we've seen in the history of the United States.
The House is in agreement with that.
And. But I'd like to again to touch on process. I mean, that's my focus. And this polarization of our two-party system, this whole love-hate theme, and how this love-hate theme conflicts with this PC theme, and how we're at each other about whether or not anybody loves anyone. I, of course, am transgender. I have been out for at some level for almost 20 years. And I have watched how my community has struggled with the challenge of dealing with me and what I represent. And I've seen enormous change, and I will continue to see enormous change. People are beginning to understand it. More people are beginning to accept it as something that's very real. So that's a good thing. And the only thing I want to say about the bathroom issues is that, I mean, that will pass eventually as well. If you're going to use a public restroom, please wash your hands.
And as a nurse, I agree.
I'm just up here again to add some information to something that was just recently said again about talking about the Muslim ban. I also just recently, a few Saturdays ago, got the wonderful experience to listen to a speaker talk about her experience living in the Japanese internment camps. She lived in a camp in Idaho. She was from Seattle. She got moved there with her family. It was a family of 10 children and her two parents. And she was only in first grade when she had to make this. Now, they ended up coming to live in Minnesota because of her brother working for the military intelligence and was based in Fort Snelling, and ended up coming and kept on working to get more family members here to Minnesota. And so they were all born while they were here. All the children were born while they were here in the United States, so they were all United States citizens. And they got moved to what she called the concentration camps. And the way that she described them to us, they were definitely concentration camps. But one of her points during this presentation that I wanted to share with all of you is she put up this statement that was made by the chief military person in charge of the internment camps as they started to occur. And what she pointed out to us was that statement was exactly what somebody said regarding their Muslim ban during the campaign. So that is the logic which we, many years later, figured out was wrong and ended up issuing the apology to the Japanese citizens or Japanese American citizens and gave them, you know, $20,000 per person for their time in the camps. So again, part of this whole, you know, immigrant discussion doesn't have logic when you realize how much many of these immigrants, or most of these immigrants, are adding to our communities and to our country.
case, and it's in one of the many things I've sent to you. That whole America First thing you keep hearing, America First, that was back from like the late 20s when they turned away the boat of Jews who was trying to escape the Holocaust. And during the campaign, the American Defamation League asked them to please stop using those words. And so really listen for that, because that sends a real clear message to the people that support that whole idea. So that inciting hate really bugs me. Words matter.
Words matter.
Yes, it does.
I just want to say there's been some really great comments here today, and I wonder, can we go back home and call Jason Lewis and say, I was at the town hall meeting, I wish you had been there, I missed you. Can we do that?
One that's been absent, that's another executive order, is reversing to promote again the privatization of prisons.
Oh. Yeah.
And I think universally we need to be aware of it, and we need to speak out, and we need to ask him where he stands on this. That we should not be having profit centers be something that is continuing and perpetuating injustice. And so we need to stand and speak out on that.
I was with the Women's March Minnesota, so hopefully everybody was like, thank you. 100,000 women and allies, January 21st. That's a lot of passion. That's a lot of energy. So I just want to say thank you. I was Facebooking with everybody. There's a lot of folks that share your energy and passion, and I just want to reiterate, go out. This is just the beginning, right? We have to make our voices heard. Story is, I just want Jason to know, if you want healthy babies, you need healthy mothers. So you need to fund Planned Parenthood. I was a college kid down in Mankato, and that's where I went for my health care. They were able to identify that I had anemia. That has nothing to do with anything else. It was the fact that they were a provider for women's health, and that's what we need to continue to do. So thank you very much for being here.
Is there anybody else that wanted to come up and share anything?
Well, I'm not a constituent, so.
What are you?
$300.
We hear all voices. I just wanted to know how you identified yourself.
I just want to tell Jason Lewis that he scares me. The current an occupant does, and I'm impressed.
Thank I agree.
From Shakopee, so I am your constituent, and I just want to let everyone here know that Mr. Lewis was at the city council meeting in Shakopee on Tuesday evening. Nobody knew except the mayor of Shakopee.
Oh.
Yes. Yeah. So one of the councilman Whiting, did inform Mr. Lewis that he has a lot of constituents, which is pretty obvious here today, that have a lot of questions. So I would encourage you, Mr. Lewis, to show up at one of these meetings. Thank you.
Private
schedules for people who we employ. I don't understand that. So if somebody can explain that to me, Jason, please do.
I really didn't want to come up here again because I get tongue-tied, but we need more young people involved. Yeah. Really got to get the young people involved because they're the hope. They're the future.
My name is Jim Kuhn, and I live in West St. Paul. This is fantastic. I keep telling my four children that this country will be better because of the situation and the feelings. So we need to make that happen. As we look at future meetings like this and having Jason come to them, I would just share that, you know, there are trade-offs, and there are trade-offs that we need to make, that we need to share with the congressman. I was at a town hall meeting in South Minneapolis a few months ago, and we're talking about police violence and racism, and Keith Ellison was the congressman. He was there and said, if you want to know what you can do about the problem, how have you expressed that you don't want to be protected at the cost of injustices to others? You know, what are the trade-offs? If we want health care, if it would benefit us to have health care for all, is that something that we would do without, or something that we would pay more for? What are the trade-offs? Because that's the type of thing that I think these folks need to know. And it can't be one side against the other. I recall also I was on a plane ride about 5 years ago. I have been a Republican. But I'm an independent now. I was railing against the administration at the Times, the poor judgment in handling the economic crisis, the poor judgment in setting up Obamacare, and all of these things. And the gentleman I was sitting next to said, "You know what? The problem isn't the administration. The problem is that the administration's got nobody to talk to, nobody to work with, nobody to figure out what the trade-offs are, because it's a zero-sum game. If we want something, we've got to pay for it, or we've got to do without something else. It's always also easier if America is growing and the economy is growing. There's more that we can afford to do, but that's another point itself. So I guess my thought is, as we have the next ones, how can we tee up? What are the trade-offs? What can we say that will actually help in those decisions? I agree.
So he could get the information if he wanted it. Yeah. We're all willing to share our viewpoints, right?
Exactly. Yeah.
CNN reports former Labor Secretary Tom Perez elected DNC chair.
Okay.
Oh. Chief is deputy chair.
If we come together and focus on what we need to be focused on.
Hi, my name is Sasha Williams. I also was not paid to be here. My main concern is education. As you all know, unfortunately, Betsy DeVos is the head of the Department of Education. And my main concern is I was a special ed student all throughout my elementary and college years. As someone who has benefited from the Americans with Disabilities Act and IDEA, stands for Individuals with Disabilities Act of 2004. How does this woman have no idea what these two acronyms mean? And why are you even involved if your main priority is having guns in school to kill grizzly bears. And as someone who has benefited with Section 504 in college, my main question for Jason Lewis is, how are you going to have Betsy Davis be held accountable to help help special ed students in Minnesota not feel like a second priority?
Hello. My name is Dustin Cesarek. My wife Kim was up here not too long ago. Obviously, there's a big issue that I could talk about. It could be healthcare. I'm not going to because a lot of people have talked about it. And I was just staying back there thinking there's been so much substance going on today, I think I'm going to have to go home and take a nap. Yeah, I'm kind of feeling a little drained from it all. But what I wanted to bring up from some of the comments that I've heard was just this idea of, you know, Congressman Lewis isn't here, and we all certainly wish he was here. But for me, it's important to remember that he's not my enemy, he's not my opponent, even though I disagree with him on so many issues. Really, he's supposed to be my leader. And my question to Congressman Lewis would be, please be the leader that you're supposed to be to all of us. Represent people who you don't necessarily agree with just by listening to them, by being here and listening to their perspectives, so that you can apply the critical thinking ability that I know you have, that I trust you have, to make effective decisions in the position that you're in. And to all of us, everyone who's here, I wanted to pose, if he doesn't do that, what are we going to do to change the dialogue? Because right now, what the system that's perpetuated is it's us versus them, it's Democrats versus Republicans, it's liberals versus conservatives, and that has to stop. Otherwise, the chasm is going to keep growing, and the system is just going to continue to fall apart. So of everybody in the room, you know, we all have jobs, we all have stuff to do. I have a wife with cancer, you know. We all have our issues that we have to deal with. But how are we individually going to take the time to affect the dialogue? Who's going to run for office? Who's going to get involved with nonprofits? Who's going to advocate for people who can't advocate for themselves? So that's the question I would pose to all of you. In the instance that Congressman Lewis doesn't listen to us and be a leader for us.
My name is Cheryl O'Daniel, and I'm just going to tell you a quick little part of my story. In July, I had a quadruple hook bypass. I could have been Princess Leia. I could possibly not be it. But because I have excellent insurance, I think better than yours, Jason, I survived. And because of the ACA, the excellence, and I'm a nurse, the excellence in our healthcare process is just getting better. And I survived it. And I'm more active, and I am stronger than I ever have been. But every time they started putting on the radio or on the TV when I was in the hospital that they were going to dismantle the ACA, my blood pressure went up to 250, 200, and I started going into cardiac arrest. Oh. So they turned off my TV. And I'm here. And I'll be damned. Excuse me, but I'll be damned if I survived a quadruple bypass to come back and live in a world of hate. Yeah. I wish you'd like pseudo tumor in my eye. At first they told me, pseudo tumor. At first they told me it was something else, which meant that they were going to go do brain surgery, which scared me to death, because I have so few brain cells left after this election that I can't afford to lose any. But now it's a pseudo tumor. So that sounds pretty good, right? But really not, because in and out I lose vision in my eye, and we're treating it with steroids, and we hope that works. So, and if it doesn't, well, we have to figure out something else. But I did not come here today to talk about that. I have excellent health care. And everybody should.
So to the last gentleman who said, what are we all going to do? I met Cheryl through this organization, and when I said she's the heart of the organization, now you understand the story that she's the heart for all of us. And if she can step up and do the work, if she can step up and reach out to everybody, if she can make it her life's mission to make this a great place, I think we all can.
The day after the election, I became so depressed I couldn't get out of my bed for a week. And I went, well, this is no life. You know, why did I survive? Why did I survive? This is just depressing. So I decided on that day, on that seventh day, that Donald Trump and Jason Lewis created an activist. Okay? I miss my president. I went to meet with him before he even ran and said, you're the fulfillment of Martin Luther, please run. In retrospect, I was ashamed I asked him to run, because the Republicans sat on their hands when we had a deep hole to fix, and so he fixed it the best we can, and Democrats didn't have his back as we asked him to do the hard work. So I wrote him another letter, and I said, you know, on Christmas Day, I said, I'm ashamed that I asked you, and I didn't have your back, and I feel bad, but I need you to do one thing. I need you to rebuild our neighborhoods and our schools. They're falling apart. Our people are falling apart. We don't know who to trust. We don't know if we can trust politicians. We don't know if we can even trust our religious leaders. Help us. I didn't mail that letter. I'm going to tell you why. Because I asked enough of that man. Now it's time for me to organize, for me to mobilize, and for all of us to become an activist. So next time you come here, you bring your Republican neighbors, you bring your Tea Party neighbors. I'm going into everybody and I'm asking them, because I'm developing an organization that is looking for the heart of America. Because if we don't put our heart back in our country, we don't have a country. We don't have to worry about anybody else destroying us, because we're destroying ourselves. We're all Americans. And only when we have heart in America, will America be great.
All right. How's everybody feeling? If I didn't acknowledge Dana. Dana, I don't know if you're in the room.
Yep, she's right there.
Dana, please stand up. Dana is a tireless fighter for our group. Stand up, Minnesota, Dakota County. And Dana has been the champion behind organizing these town halls. She's done two. And the outpouring that we see and all of the voices that we've heard today from the bottom of my heart, and I'm sure Stand Up Minnesota Dakota County thanks everybody as well. Thank you for coming out. Thank you. I'm going to give a little wrap-up speech, and I promise it's going to be really short, but it's meant to be a rallying cry, a plea for help, all of the above. So before I go any further, there's this little fake news fact that's going around, that those of us organizing these events, that we're paid. There's those signs, put them up. We're professionals, that's what I hear.
Yeah, the signs would be obvious.
There you go. Yeah. So I'm going to say, first and foremost, I'm a professional. I'm a professional mom. That's what I am. I'm also an immigrant and a proud American. I'm also a woman who found my courage to move from venting on Facebook after the loss of the elections, because I needed to get off of Facebook and yelling was not getting me anywhere. And I found a meeting on Facebook, and I attended at Hy-Vee, and there were seven of us sitting there, coffee and conversation, and we were just having that little let it out moment. And out of that little coffee and conversation meeting, we have now grown to a group of 824 friends on Facebook who help us to do all of what you see here today. So round of applause. So when they tell you that we are being paid, remind them that each one of you make up what's called a grassroots movement. 2 weeks ago, and I tweeted, it said we had 769 members. Last night we were 824. I'm pretty sure when I go back tonight, it's probably going to be higher. We are continuing to grow. I live here in Burnsville. I'm a resident of CD2. And a reminder again to Jason, I'm not paid. I'm just here for the same reason that all of you are here, is just to be heard. I am here today because I'm worried about now. I'm worried about tomorrow. And I fear for the future. I'm here today with all of you because with every new executive order, I am more afraid. Jason Lewis was elected to be our representative, and he is doing nothing to calm our fears. Absolutely nothing. Instead, he leaves us frustrated and very tired and trying to get us to focus our attention on what matters most to us. It's constantly ignored. Representative Lewis, do our fears, our concerns, our worries, do they matter to you? That's my message and my question to him. No matter how long, how Minnesota nice, how politely we speak, we continue to be ignored by you. We marched on January 21st. The world heard us. Jason did not. Multiple visits to your office last month, last week, and again today, we are ignored. The chair where he sits, he should have been sitting, now empty. I want you to take a moment to remember this moment, what it feels like looking at a representative that's not here for us. So our list of concerns and our fears grow longer every day. Health insurance, not being able to afford college, choosing between your medication and your next meal, Social Security, losing or not finding a good job or losing your home, a decent living wage. Families, neighbors, friends targeted by heartless decisions made in Washington, D.C., and a representative who cares more about voting lockstep with his party's position to ensure he is liked, and cares less about doing what is right for CD2. Just think about that. We saw his record, locked up with Trump, and he hasn't listened to us. So I know you've all got the I'm here to be heard signs. Just lift them up, please. So of the relationship our elected officials have had with us for a very long time. We too have to own that we did not always tune in to listen or participate. We are now awake, and the reality of what we are looking at, we're fully dialed in. So I'm going to ask everyone in the room today, when it's time for elections, our politicians are almost always our best friend. Aren't they?
Yeah.
They're our best friends.
They show up.
When they win, Jason, phones take a really long time to get installed. Our written letters need to be transcribed, and that's not a joke. Their schedules are always too busy. They hide behind tele-town halls. They call you when it's convenient for them. We send tweets, we post messages, yet nothing. I know I'm tired of chasing Jason, but my fired up is fired up. Is your fired up? Consider you my friends now. I'm going to ask you two questions. Is it time for us to change our relationship status with Jason from it's complicated to you're fired? My second question to you, which is the issues that matter to you, will it move you to meaningful action? Tomorrow, next week, next month, in 2018. Will you want a representative who values who we are, who will sit down with us, have a conversation, and listen to us? So my ask of every one of you here today, which is going to be, what will your courage move you to do? What will your courage be to help you stay engaged? So because of my son, I will continue to show up and speak out and stand up and organize. So 3 months, 6 months, a year, 4 years, we need to stay engaged, and so will I. We need to pick each other up and pick up the baton when some of us get just a little bit weary, because this takes a lot of work. I hope that you stand with us by reaching out to Stand Up Dakota County and ask, what can I do? For you, for me, for your children. What can you do to help? We'd love to have you join us. So as I close today, I'm gonna ask for us to just renew that commitment to volunteer, to organize, and support one another in holding our leaders accountable, and move forward with the passion and the energy to find and support a new representative who will listen to all of CD2.
Touch with him. But just a reminder too, we do have the petition out there on change.org. If you go there and search Jason Lewis, there's an opportunity again. It's basically requesting a town hall, even though these were listed. We can move that forward to the future too. So just one more way to have your voice heard. Bring up your card.